It was a pretty eventful first month on the job for Congressman Chris Pappas. Washington has emerged from the longest shutdown in its history, but another one is looming. Representative Pappas joins us to discuss this morning. How you doing?
Good morning. Great to be with you.
So that February 15th deadline is looming, and certainly there's been a lot of talk about what to do next. The first shutdown started before you were sworn in, so you didn't really have any ownership over that, but this one is happening on your watch. Do you feel some personal responsibility to get this one done?
Everyone in Washington needs to own up to their responsibility, and we should have never been in a shutdown in the first place. That's not an appropriate tool to be used as leverage. We shouldn't be playing politics with the livelihoods of hundreds of thousands of federal workers or people that rely on government services. We have a democratic process for a reason, and it's important that we talk to one another, that we take votes on important proposals, and that we move forward. That should be the vehicle for how we address our differences. So there's a committee of conference that's meeting right now. They have until the 15th to come up with a solution for how to extend government funding. They're doing some good work and having productive conversations, and so I'm slightly optimistic that they're going to come up with something that's workable that can get the support of Republicans and Democrats in the House and in the Senate. But in the meantime, we've got to focus on how we prevent this from ever happening again and preventing the sort of dislocation that we've seen for so many individuals in this country. And there was a group of freshmen that I joined to file the Shutdown to End All Shutdowns Act, which looks to implement an automatic 30-day extension in government funding, which will cut the pay of members of the administration and members of Congress so that they will have incentive to get to the table and to have discussions on how to move forward. We've got to look for ways to fund our government on a long-term basis. We shouldn't be lurching from one manufactured crisis to the next. Let's put that aside and let's focus on the job that we were sent there to do. And I think that's what the American people are looking for.
The Democrats have said no wall. That's essentially off the table. But they've also said, you know, you reopen the government, we'll negotiate. So where do you stand on this in terms of how much of a barrier or money for a barrier would you accept in any kind of compromise deal?
We need to be investing in evidence-based border security solutions that can keep our country safer. We saw last week the biggest bust of fentanyl along our southern border. It was seized at a checkpoint by an officer who did some good police work and found 254 pounds of fentanyl on a semi that was carrying produce into this country. The DEA tells us that 90% of the drugs that are reaching our country illegally are coming through our ports of entry. And so that tells me, and the experts will tell you, that we need advanced technology. We need to invest in manpower to truly keep our country safe. I think we've got to look for ways to invest in things that are going to make sense. I don't think a big concrete wall the entire length of our southern border makes any sense geographically or in terms of security reasons. But I think there are some provisions that Congress can look at that will advance the security of this country.
Certainly, this was very difficult for federal workers. But in particular, you had one group, members of the U.S. military, the Coast Guard, they had here in New Hampshire having to access food banks in order to help their families eat. Is there anything that can be done to ensure, even I know you want to stop all shutdowns moving forward, but to ensure if this does happen again, that members of our U.S. military are not impacted by this?
Well, it was shameful, the treatment that the Coast Guard received, and they're in a precarious position already because they need to ensure that they can continue to recruit individuals. And so there's going to be a residual impact from this. People will look at the Coast Guard or other ways that they could serve in federal service and think, do I want to get into a job like that where I'm not sure if I'm going to get a paycheck on time? And so that's the unfortunate reality of what this shutdown creates. I did support and co-sponsor legislation to pay the Coast Guard during the shutdown. We should never let our military service members or any federal worker for that matter be the victim of a shutdown. That's why I'm supporting the legislation that I signed on to with the group of freshmen to make sure that we don't get in this situation, that there's an automatic continuing resolution that will pay people and keep government open.
At the top of the legislative agenda is this H.R. 1, which is kind of like a laundry list of a lot of things that Democrats want to get done. But there's election reform, making federal elections a federal holiday, and also some redistricting stuff in there in terms of taking power away from the states to ensure that there will be independent redistricting. Tell us about H.R. 1 and why you support it, and we'll get into that redistricting in a bit there.
It's important that people have the power power in our democracy. And right now, there's outsized influence that goes to big corporations, to special interests in Washington. They have too much control over our elections. They have way too much control when it comes over to the types of policies that we see being pushed in Congress. So we've got to break the linkage between big money and how Congress functions and how our campaigns are run. This legislation will do that. We're going to see a push to pass a comprehensive package probably in February after several committees hold hearings on this. And then the legislation will be broken down into component parts so that we can consider each one by one. And I'm hopeful that at least some of them will gain some broad bipartisan support. When you talk to people, regardless of what their party is, they understand that money has a corrosive influence on our politics. We also have to look for ways to make sure that we protect voting rights. There have been some very serious examples over the last few years of votes being stolen in North Carolina, of voter suppression legislation being passed in states like New Hampshire and other places around the country. And so I think we have to ensure that voters have the final say, that the destiny of this country, of our democracy, is in their hands and not in the interests, not in the hands of the special interests and the powerful.
Shouldn't the states, though, or at least somebody closer to the local level, have the right to redraw the lines for congressional districts? It seems like this would remove it from the people almost a little bit, but with layer-wise.
Well, this would support independent commissions being set up in states, and I think that's absolutely the right way to go. There's legislation pending in New Hampshire that would do just that. We've seen on the state level districts that have been gerrymandered to advantage a certain party. And once again, I don't think that politicians should be picking their voters. It should be the other way around. And we should take the power out of the hands of the parties and put it in independent commissions that can draw fair districts, that keep together communities of interest, and ensure that elections will be competitive. You know, there are two types of members of Congress. They're the ones that never have to worry about re-election. They can basically do whatever they want in Washington. And then there are very few of us that represent competitive districts. I think there should be more that come from the competitive kinds of seats where politicians are accountable to the voters that they represent.
Some of your fellow freshmen want to raise the top tax rate on the wealthy to 70%. Are you on board?
I think that we need to make sure that all taxpayers are paying their fair share. I did not support the tax legislation that was passed last year, which gave big tax breaks to the wealthiest Americans, to the biggest corporations. We're facing a $23 trillion debt in this country, $1 trillion annual deficits. It's unsustainable. If we're going to make sure that we can invest in the priorities of tomorrow, the things that can grow the economic pie for everyone, we've got to have a tax code that works. And so, you know, we'll see what legislation comes forward on that. I'm willing to consider bills that will invest in the middle class, will invest in things like higher education. It's harder and harder to do that if we have a growing deficit.
So safe to say, maybe not on board with 70%, but you're expecting taxes to go up on the wealthy.
Well, I think that the super rich, the top 0.1%, which owns as much wealth as the bottom 90% of individuals in this country combined, has had all the breaks in the world. We need to make sure we have a level playing field for middle-class families who are constantly squeezed.
We're starting to see more and more of these potential presidential contenders, some of them declared, some of them not, come to New Hampshire. You were in a primary with 11 candidates last year, and this one could be twice or three times as many of that on the Democratic side. Do you see yourself at some point making an endorsement in this race, or are you just going to hold back and let things sort themselves out?
I can testify from my experience in 2018 that primaries are a good thing, that when there's competition, when voters have a choice, when they have many avenues by which to engage in the political process, that we all win as a result. So we had a positive conversation in our congressional primary last year. I think I was a stronger nominee because of it, and I think we brought along more voters in building a coalition to win the seat because of the primary campaign that myself and so many other candidates were a part of. So I'm looking forward to the broad range of voices who are stepping forward to run for president. I don't anticipate making an early endorsement of a candidate. I think the voters should be the ones that are really driving this process. When I meet candidates who are running for president or thinking of it, I really encourage them to run grassroots campaigns, have a strong field operation, talk to the voters of New Hampshire, hear what's on their minds, because ultimately I think it's going to shape how they move forward and the policies that they're proposing. We saw just after 2016 many candidates talking about the opioid crisis on a national level. That was was because they had really intimate conversations with voters here in New Hampshire and heard horrific stories of how that crisis was impacting communities and families all across our state. So we have an opportunity to do that, to size people up, and I want the voters of New Hampshire to be leading that charge.
Very curious to ask your opinion of one soon-to-be-declared candidate in particular, Tulsi Gabbard, your colleague in Congress. In her past, had said and believed some very severely anti-gay things. She since apologized and said her beliefs have changed. From your perspective, does that past disqualify her in some way from being the standard bearer for your party?
Well, certainly you would like every individual who's stepping forward to run for president to have been a champion for equality their entire political careers. She was not. And she made some statements which I have a hard time digesting. I think it's important that we recognize that if we're going to achieve true equality, if we're going to ensure that everyone is respected and protected under the law, that we need to change some minds. And so I'm glad that she has the position that she does today, and we need to look for more ways to encourage more folks to change their views and ensure that they're looking out for their neighbors.
Congressman Chris Pappas, we thank you for your time.
Thanks very much.